In this video, I would like to introduce you to the paper I wrote together with Markus Jäger, Stefan Krugel, Joachim Pallenbrock, and Peter Schwender. In particular, how we used R language for doing this research. First, let me talk about my project, the project where this research started. It's called FinNet, it's a Marie Curie. And that allows you to do your research project in a company. Started in finance and now is moving the project to Munich Re. Before, I was associate researcher in the Machine Learning Optimization Lab at the RIST Institute in Romania. If you have any question about this research, you can write me in these contacts. So, in the paper, we propose a pipeline for testing heuristic strategies that goes beyond the usual way of testing strategies in finance. In particular, we wanted to use to exploit the machine learning explanations to understand better these strategies. So, the strategies that we wanted to study are risk-based strategies, and we focused on two in particular. One is called the equal risk contribution, it's a more traditional strategy that focuses on equally distributing the risk among the assets. And we wanted to compare it with the hierarchy of risk parity, that is instead a machine learning-based strategy that uses hierarchical clustering for distributing the asset allocation. On top of it, we also use the volatility target. So how we usually study the strategies. In finance, you usually backtest them. So you look for historical data and you see how they behave, the strategies on this data. In our case, we constructed a backtest engine in R that monthly rebalances the portfolio and applies the strategy and write on disk the performances. The portfolio universe it's quite interesting. It's 18 futures and it's a very long multivariate time series. It's it covers 20 years. And it represents the different asset classes. For this portfolio, we can backtest it, and these are the outcomes. So you can see here the standard measures that are used in finance, and the performances are plotted here along the 20 years. Clearly, you want to know more about the behavior of these strategies. You don't want to test them only on one particular past. And to do this, there is a technique in finance that is widely used. It's called the block bootstrap. In practice, it's a data augmentation that from one time series, you can construct as many time series as you like. How does it work? You take your multivariate time series and you extract block of fixed length. You sample them randomly and then you recompose a new time series. And we did it 100,000 times, creating 100,000 CSV files. If you see here the empirical dataset, so the original time series, as a period that is highly volatile here, corresponding around the 2008 crisis. And you can see here in the random bootstrap time series, this happens twice. So in this way, the second portfolio is more volatile. So you can study situations in which, for example, there is a higher volatility or volatility that lasts for a longer time. So how did we backtest all these bootstrap time series? we used our backtest engine, and this backtest engine takes one CSV file and write the performances on this. To do it, to scale to 100,000 Bootstrap files, we decided to assign to every R process a single CPU. So every R process will look for one CSV and produce the output, and will use only one CPU. In this way, we could parallelize all the Bootstrap files, and to scale up, we use the AWS computational instances. In particular, we use the very big instances like C5 with the 96 CPUs. Actually, we didn't use just one of these large instances, so we used 15 of them. So how did we distribute the task among the 15 instances? One strategy was to use a shared file system among all the instances, where all the Bootstrap data were written and where all the performances could be written down. However, this the starting of the process, so you have 1,400 different processes, all at the same time reading the CSV, and this create a big bottleneck from the bandwidth of the network that is the bottleneck for this process here. So a better strategy has been to replicate the data set on the local instances, so the 15 local instances on their own solid disk storage. And this way, every instance will read locally and write locally on the EDS disk assigned to it. And for at every step, for every Bootstrap CSV, we record the performances and some features that we developed for the particular portfolios that could be interesting for the analysis that we follow. At the end, when all the processes are concluded, we gather all the results in a single machine and we proceed to the analysis. For example, the following analysis is done on one instance. So the outcomes is the following. So we can see here the difference in the performances between Equalist contribution and hierarchy risk parity. In general, here we can see that hierarchy risk parity is better. It has lower volatility, slightly higher returns, and in, for example, there are these more complex measures like the karma, where the hierarchy risk parity is slightly better. But this is just a statistical analysis, so we want to go beyond that and see what happens, what makes these outcomes. To do this, we focus on only one measure, the Kalmar. The Kalmar ratio is a particular measure where that is the ratio between the returns and the max drawdown. So it's a quite non-linear measure. How do we study it? We have all these performances with all this Bootstrap data, with all these features constructed on top of all these Bootstrap data. So we train an XGBoost from these features to evaluate the difference between the Kalmar ratio of the hierarchy risk parity minus the Kalmar ratio of equal risk contribution. In this way, we can exploit machine learning explanations to understand what is the role of each feature. What are machine learning explanations? Now it's a modern topic, and it's quite interesting. I don't go into details. There is this quantity that is quite promising. It's called Shapley value that quantifies the contribution of a single feature to the model prediction, to the outcome of the model. That is, I don't go into detail. You can look at the references here or in the paper. So if you take these values and you average them together with absolute value, you can get the, what is called the variable importance. So the variables that contributed the most to the outcome. And here we can see that there are traditional measures, like, for example, the mean of the returns, so the return of the equal weight portfolio, that are maximally important to discriminate between equal risk contribution and the hierarchical risk parity. There are, we introduced also non-trivial, non-standard quantities like a cluster coefficient, that is a coefficient that you use the library in R, let's say naively, how clusterable is the, a certain quantity. In particular, a hierarchical risk parity uses hierarchical clustering. But we can go more in details. Here we use the SHOP for Extreme Boost library. And you can see here that you can go beyond this, the overall contribution and break it down and see, for example, that a higher return suggests the model to reduce the difference of the Kalman ratio. So in some sense that this quantity pushes the outcome towards equal risk contribution. And so on, you can look also, for example, mean correlation, where if the correlation matrix among the 10 series is higher, then it looks like equal risk contribution has better performances, or at least it goes in that direction. In this way, we can construct, inspect, and understand what features of the full portfolio dataset are really matters for these strategies. So, just to summary what we found. So, we used machine learning explanation to go beyond the single backtesting of strategies that is usually performed in finance. And we constructed in R a pipeline to link the performances with the properties of the portfolio universe. This way, we can understand better what are the situations in which a strategy behaves in a certain way, and the situation is better to opt for other strategies. Thank you for your attention.